Hello, good evening. It's News 360 is coming to you live from our news hub here at Adesawe in Accra. My name is Alfred Okunse.
And I'm Natalie Fort. Let's take a look at the headlines for the next 60 minutes.
News 360 headlines is brought to you by...
And headlines this evening, Food and Drugs Authority begins investigations into purported use of formalin, a solution used to preserve dead bodies to preserve salted fish known as Kobe.
Fecal matter from septic flood arena, a suburb of Accra.
And also the bulletin tonight, we bring you findings out and the essence of nationalism and patriotism as flag dripping campaign begins to mark Ghana's 60th independence anniversary.
And in business, Ghanaians eager to hear the Akufo-Addo-led government's first budget statement, expected to put the economy back on track.
And on international front tonight, a former aid worker and oil executive Hassan Ali Kahir appointed new Prime Minister of Somalia.
We have the details of these stories and many more coming up shortly. Stay with us. Thank you so much for staying with us. You're watching News 360. And this evening, we're going to be discussing quite an interesting matter on formalin, which is being used in our delicious Kobe, Alfred.
Yeah, I mean, I grew up eating Kobe. And there's many who say that it would have killed us, should have killed us already. But then again, that could be a very uninformed position. But if issues are being raised now, I think it's worth it that we look at it. And you have something in there.
Absolutely, Alfred. Let's get the details into the uses of formalin, which is an antiseptic. It is initially supposed to be used as an antiseptic disinfectant and a preservative for dead bodies. To get a better understanding, formalin is not only used for dead bodies, but it's also used in the construction industry. It's used for printing of paper. It's not something that's supposed to actually enter the human body. But in our case here in Ghana, it's being used to preserve fish, popularly known as Kobe. Let's take more on this. And formalin causes stuff like the irritation to the stomach and in extreme circumstances even results in death, in food poisoning, and in cancer. So it's very clear that it's initially not supposed to be in our food. But unfortunately, traders are using it to make sure that fish that we know as Kobe is kept and is preserved. Let's bring you more on that story as the Food and Drugs Authority has begun investigations into the purported use of formalin, and it's a solution used to preserve, as we said earlier, dead bodies. And it's now being used to preserve fish known as Kobe. The head of food safety at the Food and Drugs Authority, Miriam Lovelace Johnson, said the test results would be ready by Friday, March 3.
Minister for Environment, Science and Technology Professor Frimpong Boateng raised concerns over the health implications for consumers who eat Kobe preserved with formalin. This prompted the Food and Drugs Authority to begin investigations into the alleged practice. Head of Food Safety at the FDA, Mariam Lovelace Johnson, said the authority dealt with the issue of formalin used to preserve products in 2015. Mariam Lovelace said consumption of the formalin-preserved fish has dire health consequences and warned people in the business to stop or face the full rigors of the law.
It's a preservative for corpses. It is not edible. It's not meant for food. It must not be used for food because it's carcinogenic. Even people who just inhale them at certain doses have issues. Anyone who uses it contravenes the Public Health Act, Act 851, Section 100, Subsection 3, A, B, and E.
She advised people in the business to abide by the two best ways of preserving Kobe, which is simpler and less expensive.
Drying and salting. The drying of the Kobe reduces the water activity of the fish. Salting in itself is also another means of preservation. Many microorganisms cannot tolerate salt. The very few ones that are salt tolerant, or as we call them, halot tolerant, will not be even available to spoil the fish.
We followed up to the market to find out whether traders in the Kobe business are aware of the purported poisonous substance used in preserving salted fish.
Salted fish, otherwise known as Kobe in the local parlance, is a delicacy for many Ghanaians. We are told that they use salt in preserving it. But recently we are told again that they use formalin, which is a poisonous chemical, in preserving this delicacy. And this has become a worry to many Ghanaians.
Helen Ayibunte has been selling Kobe for 20 years and confirms the use of formalin in preservation. She claims she is able to tell the difference between the salted Kobe from the formalin preserved Kobe. Kobe that is preserved with formalin melts when it is cooked. Sometimes consumers come with such complaints, so I also change the trader I buy from. Her daily sales, she laments, has dropped. As the results from the Food and Drugs Authority are yet to be publicized, consumers of this delicacy are advised to be cautious. AC Benewanyame, TV3, Accra.
All right, so Natalie, the findings of this is going to be out on Friday. Mm-hmm. And it's, we can't wait for that.
We can't. It's very important information.
The Kobe sellers have threatened a naked demonstration, and they are requiring of the minister to retract and apologize to them, mm-hmm. because they've been doing it for quite a while. You had them 15 years.
Yeah, for 20 in some cases.
Absolutely,
yeah.
And it's quite worrying. We'll see how that pans out. But as we wait for the research details, some residents at Arena here in Accra have expressed fear over a possible outbreak of cholera in the community following the flooding of their homes with fecal matter from cesspit and also drainage systems. We're told they lamented they have had to wade through fecal waste for the past 2 days. Solis Uskote has the rest of the story.
The stench that greeted the news team was simply unbearable. The drainage systems overflowed with fecal waste. Residents looked on helplessly as the feces invaded their various compounds. One has to wade through this human waste to access this bathroom area. This makeshift bridge, made of some old planks, was the only way out of the main rooms to avoid a fecal bath. Residents lamented the situation was unacceptable and life-threatening.
We were here one night when we realized the water is coming from our bathroom, from our toilet, and from every other means that the water can come from. And then we've tried calling to whoever we can, the authorities, to just help us put a stop to this. And for the past 2 days, nothing has been done.
I'm even thinking about the kids in the house. It's an epidemic. It should be in case. It's terrible.
Director in charge of sewerage at the Accra Metropolitan Assembly, Stephen Akon, told TV3 in a phone interview that two teams had been assigned since Tuesday dawn to dredge the sewerage system. Arena is primarily a business hub noted for the sale of building materials. The situation has created a very unhealthy environment for the thousands of traders and customers who do business there every day.
Nothing is going on well here because of the stench. Food vendors are suffering because there's feces everywhere.
For the last 2 days, this has been the routine for Madame Ansan. She wades through the feces to enter and leave her room.
We are really suffering in this area. The sewage seeps into our houses. How will our families survive? We are calling on the authorities to come to our aid. It is urgent.
Madame Ansa's only protection against possible diseases is a bucket of antiseptic and kerosene, which she uses to wash her feet after every single trip. Experts say that there are more bacteria in the feces of one person than all the human beings that have ever walked this earth. Cholera, worm infestation, diarrhea, sinus problems, fever and stomach pains are likely to reign in this community should the fecal matter not be cleared as soon as possible.
It's been barely an hour since the news team arrived here in Arena in Accra, and already our feet and our clothes are already reeking from the stench. This is what the residents of Arena have been enduring over the last 48 hours. We are looking at an imminent cholera outbreak on our hands. Solis Rose Quarte, TV3, Arena, Accra.
So clearly that is a very worrying situation.
Very
you had
worrying.
To see Solis Rose Quarte being carried shoulder high there because of the health hazards
Hazards aside, cholera would be numerous.
Absolutely.
I mean, every time that elderly lady walks through, she has to then clean her feet. It's worrying.
It's a pretty sad situation. We want to stay the steam a bit further on this. I've been joined via Skype at the moment to just help us understand this, because the situation at the arena can't best be described as a time bomb in terms of the health that they're exposed to. This is because most of these sewers are over 40 years and are flushed directly into the sea. Issa Balima is the country manager of programs manager, Masia Water and Sanitation Unit here for the urban, and also joining us here to help us understand this. I thank you very much, Issa. If you can hear me, good evening to you. Now, would you say that this is a clear failure on the part of the sanitation officers at the Accra Metropolitan Assembly and to have checked this to prevent this from happening?
Thank you so much. Thank you so much to you and your cherished viewers. I think this issue goes beyond the KMA sanitation department. It's a manifestation of a complete failure on the part of government and on the part of citizens to contribute to improving sanitation situation. What you see there today is probably the fact that the systems that have been put in place over the years have not been attended to. And like any other infrastructure, if you put infrastructure in and you don't have a very robust operation and maintenance system, that would ensure that you generate the required resources to be able to invest in improving it and expanding it. Then it will fail to serve its purpose. Every infrastructure that is designed also have a design period or a design horizon. And so these infrastructure that you have there probably have outlived their design period, the period for which they were designed, or even the populations for which they were designed. And that requires that new investment is put in to expand them and to make them workable. That's one angle of the matter. Mm-hmm. But the most serious part is the fact that for 2 days or so, we haven't seen any response from AMA to deal with the issue. It shows that the sanitation department, waste management department of AMA, does not have the capacity in terms of resources to be able to mobilize to respond to this issue. Because where we are talking now is a very central part of Accra and very crowded. And so any outbreak of cholera and other water and sanitation related diseases would, have ripple effects in the whole of Accra. So it requires that at least by now, there should be, if there is not, there should be a cholera response team that should deal with such issues and not just leaving it to the sanitation department to deal with.
Well, you talked about the new investment needed in that particular area, and that leads me to my next question. Because if we're talking about investment, in how should the investment be used? How should it be targeted? Is it rehabilitation of these cesspits which already exist, which have not been changed over 40 years, or otherwise?
Obviously, there are a number of sewage systems in Accra that have not been attended to for the past 15 to 20 years. They are dotted around. I think that there's a need to do a feasibility study and appraisal of all these systems. And that would indicate whether we are abandoning them altogether, or we are going to rehabilitate them, or we are going to replace them with new systems altogether.
you need to do that and cost it. Then you know the financial outlay that is required for this. Then you can then compare them to probably having on-site systems. On-site systems simply means that you have a toilet and you have a septic tank and it's contained. If you cost it against this, then you would know whether it makes financial sense to go back and rehabilitate these or invest in new infrastructure to be able to provide the services that is required for these people.
Okay.
Obviously, we have no choice than to make sure that the residents of this area are serviced with improved sanitation facilities.
To the extent that this has been going on for the past 2 days, the situation you saw on the television has been there for 2 days. Clearly, the inaction on the part of the Accra Metropolitan Assembly, specifically the sanitation officers there, is exposing the lives of over 200 and over residents living in this area to a serious health danger. What would you recommend that should be the swiftness that is needed to attend to this situation?
I think that we as citizens must understand that the sanitation authorities in these countries owe us a duty. They are there to provide a service. And so if they are not providing that kind of service, or the services they are providing are not meeting the required services that we want, we have the right to challenge and a demand for improved services. So I would expect that people in this location must come together and petition Accra Metropolitan Assembly in the first instance to officially demand for the situation to be resolved if they are not coming. Thereafter, then they can look at other options that they will look at. But looking at the situation now is obviously beyond what the citizens, the residents of this area can do. And that definitely requires intervention of the city engineering, the engineering department of AMA, and also this waste management department of AMA. And so if they are not responding, then we as citizens ought to take it up and make sure that they respond to the situation. At least we, that would contribute to solving the problem than to sit down unconcerned about it.
Isa, thank you very much for this. And that clearly gives us an idea of what to expect going forward. Isaka Balima Musa is a country programs manager, water and sanitation for the urban poor, giving us the details. But it's a clear worrying
it's
situation.
It's worrying. It's extremely worrying. And it's clear and that the AMA is the answer. The swift
action.
Exactly.
That
That's
problem.
What it's needed, the swift action of the
we,
AMA.
We hope and wait to see, after airing this, what the response of the Accra Metropolitan Assembly sanitation unit will be on this.
Absolutely, Alfred. But let's turn our attention away from sanitation-related stories. And ahead of Ghana's Independence Day, the late Theodosia Okoh's greatest achievement in life was perhaps designing the national flag. When Ghana's flag replaced the Union Jack on March 6, 1957, Ghanaians beamed with a sense of patriotism. Today marks the flag draping campaign, and the news team has been finding out what it means to adorn oneself with the colors of the national flag.
Papa.
A flag is the soul of every country.
Sure.
You can't stand without a flag. Otherwise, people will not notice that this is this country or the other.
60 years on, the colors red, gold, green, and the black star still fly on.
As Ghana marks its 60th anniversary, there is the need to invoke the spirit of patriotism among citizens.
But with all the energy utilized in displaying the national flag, do these performers understand the meaning of the colors on the national flag?
With all humility, I can say about the red, because it has been a long time I learned that thing. So the red is about the blood that flows for us. I love the red, so I'm okay with the red.
What about the yellow, green, and the black?
The yellow is our gold, the prosperous grace that God gave to us. And the green is talking about it's talking about money, me, money, money.
Okay, what do you also have to say about the colors?
I don't know.
Some school children came to the rescue.
The red stands for the blood of our forefathers. The yellow stands for the mineral resources of Ghana. The green stands for the green vegetation of our land. And the black stands for the hope of Africa.
The national flag was draped on some buildings in Accra and also along some principal streets. Corporate bodies and organizations were not left out of the campaign. Some ministries, departments and agencies, including Health, Controller and Accountant General's Department and the Office of the Civil Service, had flags hoisted. However, as at the time of our visit, the Ministries of Employment, Agriculture, Justice and Attorney General, and Town and Country Planning Department had no flags hoisted. In the run-up to the 2016 elections, the colours and flags of most political parties filled up almost every available space. As Ghana marks its 60th anniversary, it is expected that the same enthusiasm used in supporting political parties will be used to rally around the flag to promote the spirit of patriotism among citizens.
I feel it is important for me to put on my colours. I put on the Ghana 50 because we are ending the 50 years, soon to enter into 60 years. And next week, you will see me in the 60 years cloth.
We have seen a lot of developments. We have peace, and we are enjoying the peace in Ghana.
You see school kids also going to school, holding the national flag and all that. This is one thing that we are very proud as a National Planning Committee. And so we earmark this particular activity as one of our flagship program in this anniversary year.
Perhaps it's time to begin a campaign to have the flag of Ghana hoisted in every home. Let's name it One Home, One Ghana Flag. For Shagabo, TV3 News.
To further discuss this issue of how relevant our national flag is to us as a people, we're joined in studio by Dr. Zagba Na Oyote, who's the Executive Director of the Ghana Museums Management Board. Welcome, Doctor. Thank you so much for your time.
It's a pleasure.
Now, today is that we are celebrating Flag Draping Day. Can you tell us how relevant is it for us to celebrate this, and how does it tie in to the sixth anniversary celebration we'll be witnessing soon?
No, a flag, as one person said recently, is the soul of a nation, is a symbol of our collective aspiration. Indeed, it is our identity as a people. In the community of nations, everybody comes with a flag that signals the things that they value. And you're not really able to identify yourself as a nation probably without that standard. And as we approach our 60th, it is good to know that we still feel proud about that flag that defined ourselves and our independence 60 years ago. It is good that people appreciate the flag. It is good that people rally around it. And it's good that we hold it up on all important occasions, not just when the Black Stars are out.
Yeah.
But the people and their flag is complex, but it's also a beautiful relationship.
Absolutely.
I do things for my country, and my country means something to me. My country delivers for me, and I deliver for my country.
Yes.
So I symbolize all of that by the flag that I hold.
Yeah, I mean, on that, to expand what you're saying, you find that a lot of Ghanaians use the flag proudly in public settings when we have the Black Stars are winning or on international platforms.
Yes.
How can we change that to just use it in our own small way in our everyday life? How important is that?
Well, I mean, people, if you go to some countries, and I don't like to make comparisons easily or lightly because there are various factors as to why people behave in different ways. But it'd be nice if people had a flag in their home. Like you see in some other contexts, every school, every home. And it then shows that you are constantly reminding yourself of the nation and the community of people that form the community, the nation that you live in. It's important.
All right. Mm. Now, would you say that the manner in which the flag is handled publicly at some, not all places, but at some places, could have an impact on how much relevance people place on it?
Yeah, because some people display flags and the flags are old and they are tattered.
Yes,
and we must not do that. Mm-hmm. It must be in good condition and it must be kept properly. And I do not think it's acceptable for people to have flags that are torn on their buildings.
Very well.
You might as well, it's not that expensive. I know that we have challenges, but if you know what the flag stands for,
it's about knowing what it stands for.
You will do well to appreciate it. And yes, let's have ceremonies that allow people to reiterate, restate, recommit to the flag. Well, it's about our aspiration as a people.
Absolutely. So you see that this gives us, this day that we are witnessing or celebrating, gives us leverage as a country.
It must do, it must do. We must remind ourselves of those things that unite us, those things that identify us, and above all, those things that testify to our aspiration. Absolutely. Yes, yes. Absolutely. The flag does that for me.
Dr. Zagba Nah Oyote, we are grateful for your time. Thank you so much.
A pleasure to be here. Thank you.
Thank you. Let's now turn attention to other stories. In line with this, former diplomat KB Asante has blamed the lack of patriotism by Ghanaians on the continuous dependency on foreign aid. Speaking on the National Flag Draping Day as part of Ghana's 60 years on celebrations, Ambassador KB Asante noted the focus and commitment of the country's leaders must change.
Former diplomat Ambassador KB Asante to find out what has become of our patriotism, what has become of our nationalism. Do we still have it as compared to 1957 and now? Where is our sense of patriotism as a country?
Well, it is still there, but it's not as strong as it was at independence. We somehow, many feel that Ghana has not done much for them, and what is worse, they expect somebody else to do things for us. They don't feel involved in development or in creating. They don't think they are responsible for creating the Ghana they want. Unfortunately, we still have this dependency syndrome. And when you have a country whose election process will determine the kind of democracy we have is funded to a large extent by outsiders, then I do not think you can say that that country is that independent. We have examples of it. The European Commission, which was supposed to observe electoral process, has come out. If you were in diplomatic corps, I don't know whether they are diplomats, I would have asked that they go back tomorrow. We declare them persona non grata. We have to rely on the outside world. You rely on them not as beggars, but as partners in global development.
Where is this going to lead us? From independence, it keeps on getting worse off. It's not improving our sense of patriotism.
Yes, because Nkrumah started getting doing the things we should do to get on. The world economy, as you rightly said, we live in one world, so we should be we should know what's happening in the rest of the world, and we live in this small world, so we should try to fashion our programs in accordance with development in other parts of the world. You don't want, all right, the IMF, you go there, they give you money and so on, they give advice and so on. And you don't say that we haven't got people in Ghana to give you that advice, which will enable you to get out of this difficulty and not to go there again.
How do we ensure that that sense of patriotism, that sense of nationalism that was around the country in 1957 comes back?
Our leaders should show the way. They should first of all feel that we are an independent country, and that we alone, Ghanaians, are responsible for their development. They have to be to sacrifice a little, and they should show the way.
Now let's go on to some stories. Minister of Finance, Honorable Ken Ofori-Atta, will, on behalf of His Excellency the President, present the 2017 Budget Statement and Economic Policy to Parliament on Thursday, 2nd March 2017 at 11 a.m. The 2017 budget is expected to focus on stimulating growth and job creation through private sector development and also aim at getting Ghana working again. That's the budget will include measures to restore fiscal discipline and good economic governance, transparency, and also accountable use of public resources in accordance with the new public financial management law, and also to provide a credible basis for economic policy clarity going forward. Clearly, this is what underpins the NPP's economic policy going forward. We do not have a policy document to refer to except for the manifesto that they presented to the people of Ghana ahead of the 2016 general elections. So as you see on your screens right now, I'm going to walk you through quickly, just stay closely with me, the sector by sector analysis of what they said they're going to do in their 2016 manifesto, reducing the corporate tax rate from 25 to 20%. The number of taxes they have outlined there are either going to be reduced, abolished, or increased. And this has been tagged as the nuisance taxes, you know, removing import duties on raw materials and machinery for production within the context of ECOWAS Common External Tariff Protocol. And if you recall, the Ghana Union Trade Association, GUTA, and some other bodies were not too happy about these nuisance taxes. If you move on quickly, apart from the nuisance taxes and the taxes they say they are going to abolish, the trade and industry sector as well, pursuing aggressive industrialization and value addition to agricultural produce, and also providing tax and related incentives for manufacturing businesses in sector analysis. So clearly, this is what they said we're going to do. And this underpins the expectations of the business community and then also Ghanaians largely. I've been joined in studio by Joe Jackson. He's the head of operations at Delex Finance. Good to have you, Joe.
Good to have you.
Great. Now, for you, what do you say that the expectations of Ghanaians are justified in ahead of tomorrow's budget presentation?
Let's put it this way. The MPP gave us a manifesto, and the manifesto, obviously, like you've highlighted, several things. But even more than that, the president in the State of the Nation's address outlined several things that they want to do.
Absolutely.
And said it will be detailed in the budget.
True.
So, of course, expectations are high. Mm. We're expecting to see what the stimulus for the private sector is going to be. Mm-hmm. The president has promised to reform and pay out the NHIS.
Absolutely.
We are expecting to see that. There is the issue to do with, of course, the banner one, free SHS. Mm-hmm. Where's the funding coming from?
And I'm going to ask you a bit about that, because a lot of the policies of this particular administration is heavy on expenditure, and yet still they outlined a number of taxes that they are going to abolish, and then also those ones that are going to be reduced, and also a significant reduction on, for example, the tariffs as well. And I put the emphasis on the word significant. We already have been told that a $2.4 billion energy sector debt is what we're faced with at the moment. In all this expenditure-focused policies, what are some of the avenues that can be explored in generating revenue, which you expect the budget to outline?
Listen, to be honest with you, if I don't envy Honorable Ken Oforiatta.
You don't envy him?
No.
Why?
He's between a rock and an extremely hard place. He's in a really tough situation. On one hand, they've outlined free SHS. But I tell you this, at the same time, we know that there's only 0.4% of the budget to be used.
0.4.
If you take away salaries, interest payments and statutory deductions, mm-hmm. is done. So the question you have now is that how are we going to fund all these things? And what are the real trade-offs that we're going to make? Because there's no free lunch anywhere.
Absolutely.
On one hand, we've said clearly that we're going to make the private sector give the private sector better access to funds, mm-hmm. and improve it. That means that the government is not going to borrow locally. Because if it borrows locally,
they've given indications that they are going to continue borrowing.
No, they will borrow, but they have to reduce borrowing. They have to reduce borrowing significantly, because if you don't reduce borrowing, you will drive up the cost of borrowing for the private sector. Then on one hand, you've negotiated with, or you're in negotiations with the IMF. And one, mm-hmm. of the conditionalities is that you've borrowed so heavily that at 72% plus of your GDP, you are at risk. So you're not going to be allowed to go out there and do those mega euro bond deals that you do again.
Sure.
So you can't borrow. Mm-hmm. You don't have the money. Mm-hmm. And yet we know there's industrial parks coming up. Mm-hmm. There's $1 million for each district. There's free SHS.
True.
There's the stimulus package. There's NHIS. Then there's the almighty energy sector debt, which is threatening.
And it's coming at a time when the city is also going down, really, against the three major currencies. So how does this, you expect this budget to address this? Because already we're getting indications that the Bank of Ghana is saying that they're considering the same policy of injecting dollars into the system, which you are not too happy about.
That. Forgive me. That policy will fail.
That policy will fail.
It's failed over and over and over again. Why will it be different this time? Where is the money that we're going to keep on pumping into the system to sustain the, what do you call it, the foreign currency?
Recently, it was $120 million injected.
Good. So next week, what happens? The following week, what happens? The following week, what happens? Listen, are we going to inject $120 million every week? What is happening now in this country is this. A lot of our treasury bills are actually held by foreign organizations and individuals. Now, the treasury bill rate has dropped so low that when they look at your country risk, etc., they say, no, something is not going right. Okay. So they are taking out your money and buying back dollars or whatever currency they want to hold. So what's happening? There's no dollar is falling and it will keep falling. Back to the budget. That's why I say
very quickly.
I don't envy him. Mm-hmm. It's a very tough situation. He has to have a balancing act like no other.
Okay.
And truly tomorrow expect to see real trade-offs.
Okay, thank you. Joe Jackson is head of operations at the election. There's a lot more. I think after tomorrow we'll get to engage a lot more on this, but grateful. And there's still to come on a lot more on Ghana's 60th anniversary celebrations, Ghana 60 years on, and also an international forum for my aid worker and oil executive Hassan Ali Kairi, appointed new prime minister of Somalia. The details of these stories and more here on a News 360. Stay with us, we'll be back shortly.
Can come true with Airtel. Recharge with 2 Ghana cedis and more and get instant prizes guaranteed. Keep scratching to win mobile devices daily. 10,000 cedis weekly, 25,000 cedis monthly, and the grand prize of 150,000 cedis. Womenye. Airtel, the smartphone network.
A baby is the best gift from God to mom. Soft care is the best gift from mom to baby. The soft cotton material gives the child maximum comfort. Enjoy free time. Enjoy happy time. Enjoy soft care time.
Soft care, baby diaper. More care, more love.
Soft care, baby diaper. Best gift for baby.
Cerelac, with exclusive Bifidus BL, helps protect your baby. Nestle Cerelac. Grow strong, grow happy.
Greatest!
We now use pig milk in this family with its new pea cream. And the low cholesterol is good for me. See?
New pea cream. Great taste, low cholesterol.
Everyday Men Sport. Powerful body care for active men. Dream.
You're still watching News 360. Thanks for staying with us. Time for us to do business. I'm sure you've had a feel of more business, but let's look at some other parts apart from the budget. My name is Nanikia Mensah-Abrampa. Business Development Minister Dr. Mohammed Awal has hinted that policies that will boost the development of the private sector, including the removal of nuisance taxes, should be contained in tomorrow's budget. He gave the assurance that government is committed to ensuring a stable business environment.
It's not too good now. So the government has put in initiatives to improve the ease of doing business. We look at the ranking for Ghana, the ease of doing business, World Bank. Ghana is about 119, which is not too good. So government has initiated policy and program to make sure that we improve this ease of doing business. One way is to remove some taxes that are inimical to business. We also want to make sure we improve upon the utilities. I mean, electricity and water. It's only one way. Also, access to raising businesses and land permits. These are some of the measures government has taken to make sure that we improve the ease of doing business and make Ghana a conducive place for running business.
And the Trade Union Congress and a labor economist have called for immediate investigations into the collection of taxes in the informal sector. The alleged monies collected contributing 65% of the total tax revenue are not accounted for.
The informal sector accounts for about 88% of Ghana's economic growth. The sector employs 70% of the country's workforce. However, it has been alleged that workers in the sector do not pay taxes. But the Trade Union Congress says the informal sector contributes 65% of total tax revenue that governments collect. Deputy Secretary General of TUC Joshua Nsan was positive taxes from the informal sector could improve government's developmental agenda.
The informal economy has unexploited potential to contribute further to economic growth and tax revenues. Exploring that potential means supporting operators in the informal economy. And as a country, you should not expect to reap when we have not sown. It is incumbent on government to support the informal economy by investing in things that matter to informal workers or hinder their growth.
A labor economist, Dr. Bambo Atin, charged government to investigate those who collect the taxes from those in the informal sector.
AMA go to Okaishi, Makola to collect them. Let's ask ourselves whether the money that they collect actually gets to AMA. And that is where we have to. The seamstress, the tailors, the hairdressers, they pay. They call something stamp tax, and they pay. So you can also say that there are some of them wage earners who are not perhaps paying the taxes that we consider to be pay as you earn. Pay as you earn. And how many are they?
Dr. Bob Watson also expressed surprise over the lack of accountability on the road fund, which was set up some 3 years ago. He asked government to also investigate those who collect the money.
Sometimes you go and then they give you the ticket until that it hasn't been stamped. And sometimes you want to even say whether you have to go back and tell them that, no, you have given me the wrong ticket. So those who are collecting may be pocketing them. And I think we just need to put measures in place and block all these holes.
And a quick one, just so you know, effective today, March 1, 2017, News at 10 will be simulcast on TV3 and 3FM 92.7. So remember, when you tune into TV3, you can also tune on radio 92.7 3FM for News at 10. And also stay with TV3 for the live coverage of the 2017 budget statement to be delivered in Parliament tomorrow. But that will do for business tonight. I'm Nanikia Mensah-Abrampa. We have sports next. Is News 360.
More and more people are using MTN mobile money in their everyday lives. Hear that? She just paid her kids' school fees. And this guy just paid for his shoes. No. You just send money to the old lady again,
it's
eh?
It's money to you. Necessary.
Very necessary.
It's like money in your pocket.
Keep up with the times. Got a payment to make? Just Momo it. It's that simple, secure, and convenient.
Welcome to the sound of better money. MTN, everywhere you go.
I am going to be your investment advisor for today.
This is how the money goes and doesn't come back if you just keep spending. If you're not careful, you'll be eating your fufu without soup.
So you need Heritage Fund, a long-term investment for your long-term projects, child's education and retirement.
Invest in First Fund to provide the best returns and ready cash in times of need.
We can help you raise money for your business or even own part of a company.
Don't do this to your money. Top up your investments regularly at our partner banks using post-dated check or cash payment at our offices.
So, do you have any questions?
Investments advice made simple. Even children understand.
Who wants to answer? Mary?
Mary has a toothache.
Oh, I see. And who knows why?
Because the tooth is too big.
No, it might be a hole in her tooth called a cavity.
That's why I brush twice a day using Colgate.
Imagine this is your tooth and these are food acids that cause cavities. Colgate with calcium and fluoride helps prevent cavities.
Who protects our teeth?
Colgate! For maximum cavity protection.
Colgate, number one brand recommended by dentists.
Hello, good evening. Welcome to the Sports Time here on News 360. My name is Michael Otieje, and let's start with breaking news relating to Ghana's search for a new coach, because Ghana has approached Cameroon's Nations Cup winning coach Hugo Bruce and Frenchman Hervé Renard as part of his headhunting strategy for a new coach. But both coaches are under contract, but there are also more than 60 coaches, including Philippe Trousier, Claude Lewa, Henri Kasbechak, former Burkina Faso coach Paul Put, and ex-PSG boss Antoine Kabore. Those names will be among the many resumes that a committee will put together by the GFA would consider. And Akia Mankwa and Vida Krenzel have been finding out exactly how the process will work and the type of coach Ghana needs.
It is that time again when coaches lobby and the GFA's mailing list is flooded with inquiries from various coaches seeking to manage the Black Stars. Six men headed by the GFA president Kwesi Nyantichi would have the task of picking who the next Black Stars coach is, but what exactly would be involved in the process? Ibrahim Sanidara is communication director of the body.
We've realized that there might be coaches who are currently in jobs who might be interested in the Black Stars position, but immediately they apply, they could be sacked by their current employers. So we decided to take the option also to perhaps even approach them and speak with them of the possibility of getting them to work for the national team. And the underlying factor for us is competence and nothing else.
In addition to the six members of that technical committee, agents would be some of the most sought after in the coaching process. They would suggest names, lobby, sell their clients through the media, and sometimes throw forward coaches who have no clue. Football agent Francis Hackman is hoping one of his clients would win and says agents would be central to the whole process.
Initially, I've applied for two of my coaches, one Brazilian and one German. It's like applying for any other job. It's 50-50. You have to let the coach know that it's a process. Sometimes you apply for a coach and he's shortlisted. Even it's another step. So when you are shortlisted, you can be called for an interview. And his ability to impress the pundits or the panelists will also be of great benefit to the coach.
But what kind of coach does Ghana need? Ex-international Sam Johnson reckons it is time to look within.
I want someone who is coming to build the local football and also the national team with the help of that person. That's why I'll be happy if they can give it to the local coaches. Why are we not respecting our and we want black white coach to come and do it before we respect? Who is white? Is it not a human being like me and you? So why are we respecting them and we don't respect our own? Why? We need to change that thing in our head. We need to change it. But because we don't respect here ourselves here, that is why all these things are happening. They should have confidence in us, like they are having the confidence in them.
Maneki Amankwa invited Akrenso with that report. Elsewhere, newly promoted side Elmina Sharks held defending champions WA All-Stars to a 1-0 draw game in WA. Richard Arthur gave the home side a lead in the 11th minute, but Sharks came fighting back with Prince Boateng snatching the crucial equaliser for them in the 54th minute. They remain unbeaten on the road, while last season's champions are still looking for their first win after two games. There will be one more outstanding game tomorrow in Accra. It's between Accra Great Olympics and Bechem United. Some tennis news now, and Britain's Andy Murray beat Guillermo Garcia Lopez 6-2-6-0 in round two of the Dubai Championship. The world number one is playing his first tournament since his fourth round defeat at the Australia Open. Murray, who won in 1 hour 12 minutes, will face Germany's Philipp Kohlschreiber in the last eight. Elsewhere in the same Dubai Open, the Australia Open champion Roger Federer has been knocked out earlier today. That's all the sports for now. Just a quick reminder, Manchester City involved in FA Cup action against Huddersfield Town. They're leading by a goal to Aguero with a goal. In Spain, Barcelona are 5-1 up against, 5-1 up in La Liga. Lionel Messi with one of the goals, 21 goals so far this season. Victory will take them top of La Liga if they're able to hold on against Sporting on before Real Madrid play later tonight. That's all the sports for now.
Fanyogo, mango, and passion. A delicious blend of two exciting flavors in a bigger pack for longer lasting refreshment. Try it now for 1 cedi 50 pesos from Fanmil.
Experience total communication solutions at the office, on the go, and at home. There's absolutely nothing you can do when you are on a super network.
I will change a few things, but tomorrow will be a brand new day. God will get me nowhere. My life is special.
This is Vodafone SuperNet.
Vodafone, power to you.
Welcome back to News 360. Before we turn our attention to international news, remember that effective today, 1st of March 2017, News at 10 will be simulcast on TV3 and 3FM 92.7, which means you can be in your car and at home and tune into News at 10. Let's now take news from the international community.
Hassan Ali Khairy, a former aid worker and oil executive, is the new Prime Minister of Somalia. President Mohamed Abdullahi Mohamed, popularly known as Farmajo, made the announcement on Twitter. After his nomination, Khairy promised to tirelessly work with the president and try to form a government that represents the public. Tensions between Somali presidents and their prime ministers in recent years have frequently stymied government business and undermined political process in the fragile Horn of African nation, so the relationship between the two men will be crucial. Khairy is from the diaspora and holds dual Norwegian and Somali citizenship. The 49-year-old has been a regional director of the Norwegian Refugee Council charity and a director of controversial British oil company Soma Oil and Gas. The appointment must now be approved by Parliament.
All right, so let's get into entertainment. In a few days, Ghana will mark 60 years of independence. But guess what? 89-year-old patron of the Convention People's Party, Balfour Kwame Asiatre, has a problem, which our reporter, Ozu Orai, has been finding out exactly what the problem is.
We now have freedom.
Ghana. The countdown for Ghana's 60th birthday is on. But hey, some Nkrumahists think there is absolutely nothing to be proud of.
The colonial people knew that if they had allowed Kwame Nkrumah to live, we would have beaten most of these countries now.
The CPP will come back.
Meet Balfour Kwame Asiatre, a thoroughbred Nkrumahist.
Ghana would have been which country?
Malaysia?
No, no, no.
Singapore?
No, no, no. A super nation.
Days to Ghana's 60th birthday, he's filled with memories of Dr. Kwame Nkrumah.
No government after Nkrumah has created any atmosphere for enjoyment by the masses of the Ghanaians.
He just came to muddy the waters.
He seriously wants to dismiss those memories. But how on earth is he going to forget them?
I think I should boost more than anybody.
No, that can kill you.
Drinking can kill you.
Mr. Asiatre is only remembering Kwame Nkrumah.
I think I should boost more than anybody else.
This is beautiful. There's a lot to recall ahead of that independence celebration. It reminds me of Nkrumah Showboy. You
know, yeah. True, very interesting.
Just let you know, effective today, the 1st of March 2017, News at 10 will be simulcast on TV3 and 3FM. What this means is that if you're driving home and you're late to watch the news on TV3 at 10 p.m., you can tune into 3FM 92.7 in your cars, on your mobile phone, in your home, and you can follow the news live right there on that particular dial.
Absolutely, Alfred. And do stay with TV3 because coming up after News 360, we have Do Not Love Me So Much, where the drama continues that.
Do Not Love Me So Much.
Absolutely. I'm Natalie Fort. We're grateful for your time this evening.
And my name is Alfred Okunse.
Have a good evening.